Good evening, and thank you for joining us. My name is Mickey Simon, and on behalf of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, it is my honor to welcome you all here tonight and to give a warm welcome to our global audience watching tonight's program online. We all come to this history in various ways. Some of us who are children of survivors grew up with this in the fabric of our lives, sometimes in a very open and conscious way, and other times in an indirect and equally powerful one. As the daughter of a Holocaust survivor, my father was in Dachau as a child. My sisters and I have an understanding of this legacy. And as a professional, a therapist, I know the power of the stories we tell. As another therapist, Esther Perel, who is also the child of Holocaust survivors, describes so brilliantly, these stories have the power to shape how we see and act in the world. Perel describes her town where she grew up in Antwerp, Belgium, of mostly Holocaust survivors, as being divided in two groups, those who did not die and those who lived. Each perspective shapes future generations and how they live with this legacy. We are obligated to continue to tell the story. As Andres so poignantly reminds us, in the near future, there will no longer be survivors among us, and it is our critical responsibility to continue to tell the story. But no matter the perspective, it breeds a commitment to our parents and our grandparents to remember and to share the story with our children and theirs. I am so happy to have one of my daughters here tonight. There are others among us, including my family, who are passionate supporters of the museum, and the work of the museum to reach millions of people around the world. But I suspect that we all share a common purpose, the belief that the Holocaust offers us an educational lesson, a perspective on what happens when societies tolerate bigotry, racism, and hate. The United States Holocaust Memorial Museum opened in 1993 with a clear mandate: to be a living memorial honoring the victims of the Holocaust by inspiring the courage to respond to events we see in our world today. The museum is here to elicit the best within us and to remind us with bold confidence that memory has the capacity to transform, that the lessons of the Holocaust have the capacity to inspire, that each of us has the ability and the responsibility to act. What you do, what we've done and will achieve together matters. This evening's program is part of a series this year entitled The Power of Memory to Shape Our Future, which explores the potential of our collective understanding of the Holocaust and the force it can be to create a better world. During this series, we'll hear from survivors, learn about institutions memorializing those who perished, and explore the range of technology and innovation that is preserving memory and making it relevant to younger audiences. To learn more about these programs, including our live stream conversations, please sign up for museum emails and follow us on social media. Tonight, we will hear from several young writers, including descendants of Holocaust survivors, grappling with trauma in their cultural past and discover what motivates them to share their stories. Now let me introduce the moderator of our program this evening, Stephen Mize, a program manager and an archival curator for over a decade.
Thank you, Mickey, for being with us tonight, and thanks to all here and at home for your participation in tonight's program. Tonight we'll hear from six authors. Each tackles the theme of memory from a different perspective. Some are the descendants of Holocaust survivors, while others are nonfiction writers exploring atrocities from their cultural past. By broadening the discussion, we hope to illuminate how the common experience of atrocities are internalized, passed down, and how writing reveals its lessons. We asked each author to respond to two specific questions about the power of memory. First, what is your biggest motivation in your writing, and how do you view your responsibility to share your story with the world? And second, the events you write about happened many years, even generations ago. What themes or messages do you hope will resonate with the reader in future? We've also asked our presenters to illustrate some of their memories and reflections with photos. After the presentations, we'll sit down for a conversation with the group and take questions from you, the audience. For those watching at home, we encourage you to share your thoughts and ask questions during tonight's program on Twitter and Facebook using the hashtag #MemoryTransferred. Books from each of our authors will be available for sale outside the theater. The authors will be available after the program to sign copies of their books. I'd like to introduce our first author. Erica Dreyfuss, author of Quiet Americans, Stories. Erica's paternal grandparents were German Jews who emigrated to New York in the late 1930s. Their histories and personal experiences have infused much of Erica's writing, which have garnered her several prestigious awards. Erica writes prose and poetry and serves as media editor for Fig Tree Books. Erica.
Good evening. It is a true honor to be part of this event. I would like to thank my fellow panelists and all of you for coming, as well as Dana and the whole United States Holocaust Memorial Museum for providing us with such a meaningful venue. Less than 2 weeks ago, we observed International Holocaust Remembrance Day. I often think that I have never really needed this day, or Yom HaShoah, which we observe each spring, to remember the Holocaust. By that, I mean that to some extent, much of my life leading up to the publication of my story collection, Quiet Americans, seems to have been a process of what the Germans call Vergangenheitsbewältigung, or coming to terms with the past. The term is typically linked to a very specific past, that of the Nazi era. Not coincidentally, it is a word that comes up in one of the stories in my book. But before we get to the book, I'd like to tell you a bit about my grandparents, Ruth and Sam Dreyfuss, whose lives and backgrounds inspired so much of what's in the pages. My father's parents, who met and married in New York City, were both German Jews. Born in 1914 and 1915, they were young adults when Hitler became chancellor in 1933. They each managed to escape Germany before the Kristallnacht of November 1938, leaving behind immediate family members whose paths to survival were more circuitous and more fraught. Just waiting to see the next picture. Well, that's another family picture. And then the next one, that's a plaque up in my grandfather's hometown for the synagogue, and explains what happened there at Kristallnacht. My grandparents had only one child, my father, and my sister and I were their only grandchildren. My grandparents both lived into their 80s, and so my sister and I were very lucky to have many years to develop relationships with them and to hear their stories. My grandparents never lost their accents, and I was always acutely aware that they had been born in Germany and that because they were Jews, it hadn't been safe for them to stay there. I don't remember a time when I wasn't aware of the Holocaust. I can remember hearing adults mention the name Hitler when I was a young child living in the predominantly Jewish Brooklyn neighborhood of Sheepshead Bay. And I remember reading Anne Frank's diary for the first time when I was about 8 years old. I was a precocious reader. It was also around that time that the miniseries Holocaust aired on television, and visual images of everything from the pre-war persecution to the gas chambers confronted me for the first time. Soon thereafter, my family moved from Sheepshead Bay to a mostly non-Jewish New Jersey neighborhood. I became slightly obsessed with the Holocaust, reading nearly every narrative I could find in my elementary school and synagogue libraries. I recall in particular one autobiography penned by a German woman who had grown up as a Mischling second degree, a child with one Jewish grandparent whose tainted ancestry marked her wartime adolescence. As the years passed, I absorbed more of my grandparents' stories, learning about when and why they emigrated and who they left behind and the relatives who suffered and died in places called Gurs and Dachau and Auschwitz. I never articulated my growing fears and increasing questions. I certainly never mentioned the recurring nightmare in which SS soldiers stormed into my suburban fourth grade classroom, tore me from my desk, and isolated me, the only Jewish student in the class, apart from my friend Eric. It had occurred to me that he would have been a Michelin first degree from my reading, to be taken away in a truck. Not until 1995, after I read the work of the now late Israeli psychologist Dan Bar-On, a book called Fear and Hope, Three Generations of the Holocaust, did I realize that mine were not the only third generation nightmares. At that time, 1995, I was a PhD student concentrating in, surprise, 20th century European history. Although in part because I'd recoiled from studying German, my specialty was modern French history. Even there, though, I zeroed in on the multi-layered subject of World War II. It was while conducting dissertation research in Paris, in fact, that I stumbled on a set of letters in the French National Archives. I like to say that those letters screamed the message, "Write a novel about us." Indeed, I spent the next several years balancing my dissertation and teaching with a growing love for fiction writing and a growing novel. Although sparked by the archival discovery, the novel allowed me to begin writing fiction connected with the Holocaust and to begin processing in that way some elements of my grandparents' history, specifically my grandmother's efforts to bring her parents to the United States and the bittersweet results. The novel did find an agent, but it never found a publisher. During that long and ultimately unsuccessful quest, I enrolled in a program leading to a Master of Fine Arts degree in creative writing, and I began writing short stories. It seemed that once I had begun writing about the Holocaust, or more specifically, about people whose lives Nazism had transformed, I couldn't stop. It's probably also worth noting that my grandmother, then my last surviving grandparent, passed away at the start of my second semester in the program. It's likely that my writing at that time helped me manage that loss. I was especially drawn to exploring circumstances and situations from my grandparents' past that struck me as truly astonishing, such as my grandfather's U.S. Army service during World War II, which included a stint during which he, a German Jew who had only just received American naturalization papers, supervised German prisoners of war in the kitchen of a POW camp in Iowa. Or the equally compelling snippet about a pediatrician my grandmother came to know when she was working as a nanny in Manhattan. This doctor was also a German-Jewish refugee, and according to my grandmother, he had made it to New York because the high-level Nazi, whose children he'd cared for back in Germany, had told him to get out of the country. Shortly after my grandmother died, I returned to that snippet. She had never disclosed, it seemed she wasn't certain, which high-level Nazi had given this important advice. So the historian in me did what historians do best, research. When I found a plausible possibility, I went with it, and the result was the opening story in my book. That story is titled For Services Rendered. For Services Rendered is one of several stories in the book that reflect an ongoing interest in the world that was left behind, an interest that I have been able to feed by returning to my grandparents' hometowns. I have now visited my grandmother's native city, Mannheim, three times. One story my grandmother told us repeatedly had to do with her first return to Mannheim in 1972. She and my grandfather were driven there just for the day by French cousins. They didn't want to spend an overnight in Germany. The car stopped outside her old apartment building. My grandmother was unable to move and never left the car. I, on the other hand, actually went into the apartment in later years. I was mindful of what had happened during her visit when I went to Mannheim and when I wrote a key scene in a story that I've titled Homecomings. Only three of the stories that I wrote in that MFA program landed in the final book, and I've just referenced two of them. The third is the story I alluded to earlier, inspired by my grandfather's army service in Iowa. That story is titled Lebensraum. At times, I considered naming the entire book Lebensraum, and that's because the more I continued to write, the more I discerned ways in which so many of my characters, or their parents and grandparents, having been chased from their original living space, were still searching for psychic and physical territory, still didn't feel safe, still couldn't fully live their lives. Shadows of Nazi persecution remained, whether the main characters were themselves refugees or survivors or children and grandchildren of the same. Preoccupations, flashbacks, pain. Freud might have identified quite a bit of remembering and repeating in my pages. He might even have agreed with my hypothesis. The historical research and the creative writing, the reconstructing of the past in my own excruciatingly informed ways, helped me in the process of working through. But working through what? What did I have to work through? The major displacement trauma of my life, that move I mentioned earlier from Brooklyn to New Jersey when I was 9, resulted from my parents' improved economic circumstances and their determination to enroll my sister and me in a superb public school system. To be sure, everyone faces obstacles and challenges, and I've had a few. But looking at the hand that life has dealt me, there's really not much to complain about. Now, the things that my grandparents and their parents, siblings, aunts, uncles, and cousins faced, those were things to work through if they survived to have the chance. But my grandparents were too busy trying to rebuild their lives, pay their rent, and feed their family to remember, repeat, and work through at the time. In my experience, writing and healing are both mysterious processes. I can't explain exactly when I started to feel some, not all, but some, of the intensity of the Holocaust legacy, some of that fear and anxiety lift from my shoulders, but I know that it has something to do with my writing. Thank you so much for your attention, and again, for welcoming all of us here this evening.
Thank you, Erica. Next is Rachel Hall. Rachel is the author of Heirlooms, inspired by her family's wartime papers and photographs, which are now part of the USHMM's archives. Thank you, Rachel, for that. Rachel's stories and essays have appeared in a number of journals and anthologies. She teaches creative writing and literature at the State University of New York, Geneseo, where she holds 2 Chancellor's Awards for excellence, one in teaching and one for her creative work. Rachel, please.
Good evening. Thank you, everyone, for being here. At a writer's conference in 2002, I attended a panel discussion on writing historical fiction. At the time, I was working on a novel about a utopian religious community set in the mid to late 1800s, a project that I interrupted to write my collection of linked stories, Heirlooms. One of the panel speakers said he thought those drawn to writing historical fiction wished they lived in the past, that writing about the past was a way of fulfilling this wish. No, I thought, I'd rather be a woman now than in any previous time in history. And in writing Heirlooms, which begins in France in 1940 on the eve of the German occupation, I wasn't fulfilling a wish to have lived there during those dark times. Certainly, I did not. Heirlooms is inspired by the stories I heard growing up from my mother, who's here tonight, and her adopted parents, whom I call my grandparents, about their lives in France during the war and their immigration to the States afterward. I heard about abrupt departures to avoid arrest, of subsisting on barley, and of the last time my mother saw the father she adored before he was arrested and then executed just before the Allied liberation. I often asked to hear these stories repeated, hoping for another detail, a newly recalled bit of information, anything that might answer the questions the stories evoked for me. Sometimes I'd get a new detail that completely changed the way I'd imagined someone. And other times I'd hear the same scant bit of information, no matter how much I badgered. I also scoured the few family photographs, family albums compiled after the war. These were arranged by my grandfather, and they were both meticulous and quirky. While the photos were labeled carefully, my grandfather was creative with order. So sometimes people seem to age backwards. Photos of my mother as a teenager come before ones of her as a solemn five-year-old. There were photos of people they'd left behind, people they never saw again when they moved to the States. And mixed in between these photos were pictures of bombed out bridges, the work of the French resistance. As a little girl, I loved particularly a photo of my mother aboard the refurbished freighter that brought her to America in 1947. 8 years old, she sits cross-legged on the deck, squinting into the sun. In her arms is a baby doll, a going-away gift from a family friend. The doll was made of celluloid, and it melted on the long, hot journey. This was a small loss, given all that had been lost. But as a girl, this detail was especially resonant for me. My childhood in America's heartland had everything my mother's lacked. And still, her stories of hardship and loss entered my dreams, became my past, my stories. Marianne Hirsch, professor of English and comparative literature at Columbia University, calls this phenomena post-memory, and first used the term in a review of Art Spiegelman's Mouse. Post-memory, she writes, describes the relationship that the generation after bears to the personal, collective, and cultural trauma of those who came before, to experiences they remember only by means of the stories, images, and behaviors among which they grew up. These experiences were transmitted to them so deeply and effectively as to seem to constitute memories in their own right. These events happened in the past, but their effects continue into the present. It wasn't until after my daughter's birth that the stories I'd heard all my life began to take shape as heirlooms. A new mother, I was learning firsthand the powerful connectedness of mother and infant, the fierceness of a baby's need, the pleasures and challenges associated with caring for a tiny new human. I understood in a new way the magnitude of my mother's losses and the way they had shaped her life and mine, and would even shape my baby daughters. Around this time, I came across a photo of my mother, one that I hadn't paid particular attention to amongst the others in the album. According to the handwriting on the scalloped border of the photo, it was taken when my mother was 6 months old. She's a plump, pretty baby. Her eyes are dark and shiny, a bit concerned, it's true, perhaps from the noise of the camera or the lights necessary to capture her image. Someone has placed her in a wooden walker with wheels, the sort of thing that would now be made out of bright plastic. I couldn't believe I'd never noticed this photo before because it now raised so many questions for me. Where was it taken? And by whom? Who dressed my mother? Found her that walker? How strange to imagine making that purchase with war imminent. There was no one who could answer these questions for me. My mother was too young at the time to remember. Her biological parents were long gone. I began to wonder, too, about the stories that my grandparents hadn't told me, or that they had softened, perhaps out of shame or guilt, or to protect me or themselves, or simply because they had forgotten as they went about the demanding work of building new lives in a new country. I wrote to make sense of this past, and because these stories mesmerized and perplexed me, because I needed to fill in the missing pieces to make sense of my family, our history, myself. It feels important to mention that this was more of a need on my part than a motivation. Writers don't choose their materials so much as it chooses them. When Helen Epstein began her project, which resulted in the seminal text, Children of the Holocaust, people were somewhat skeptical and accused her of stirring up shit to no good purpose. The next generation of writers has been more likely to elicit instead the response of, again, really? But for many of us, the past isn't ever over. We live in its long shadow, sometimes without even knowing that we might shiver in its chill. What I hope resonates for contemporary readers of heirlooms is the way that the past lives on in a family, the way secrets and omissions, loss and desire shape future generations. As a writer, I'm interested not just in the big events of a life, but in the consequences, the enduring grief, the after. How does one go on after tragedy and trauma? How is it absorbed and accommodated? I'm looking at a particular family and a particular past, but don't all families know loss and harbor secrets? And while I'm writing about the Second World War, I hope that my stories speak to the essential human experiences of exile and loss and survival, as Steve Almond has said they do. Other readers tell me that they hear disturbing echoes of heirlooms in the world today, in the nationalism, racism, anti-Semitism, and xenophobia that are again alarmingly on the rise. I hope then that heirlooms reminds us that when people are fleeing danger in their countries, we must do everything we can to lessen the trauma of leaving all they've known, home, family, language. When I see photos of Syrian refugees in worn, dirty clothing, their possessions in plastic sacks, I can't help but think of my family and the many others who looked to the States for refuge during World War II. Especially, I think of those who were turned away. While my motivation to write heirlooms was never a desire to live in France during the German occupation, I find myself in an America that is increasingly hostile to refugees, immigrants, to differences of religion, to truth and its consequences. In the New York Times editorial, Anne Frank today is a Syrian girl. Nicholas Kristof quotes Maddie J. Bekink, a consultant at the Anne Frank House in Amsterdam, who says, "No one takes their family into hiding in the heart of an occupied city unless they are out of options. No one takes their child on a flimsy boat to cross the Mediterranean unless they are desperate." To these grim alternatives, I say, again, really? Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Next is Jade Hidla, author of The Return to Vietnam. Jade holds an MFA in creative writing from CSU Long Beach and a PhD in literature from UC San Diego. She's a faculty member in the Letters Department at MiraCosta College, and she is a featured writer for the Diasporic Vietnamese Artists Network website. Jade, please.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here, and thanks to everyone who was involved in getting me here. This is quite a big deal for a little girl from the projects in Los Angeles, so I'm very happy. I'm feeling very fancy right now, microphones and everything. So when I was first presented with those questions that Stephen mentioned earlier, the first of which being, what is my motivation for writing? I was really initially thinking about how writing is a very solitary internal process, and for me, that means I've lied to all my friends and told them I'm busy for the night, and I'm at home on a Friday with a bag of Cheetos and crying and laughing at the typewriter, of course, because that's what writers do. So just like imagine Beyonce and then the opposite of that, and that's me when I'm writing. So in my book, The Return to Vietnam, that's all of that. The tears and the Cheeto dust are on every page. But post-publication, I was really reflecting on the social process of writing. As I stand here before you, I'm very cognizant of the fact that you might be looking at my face and thinking about the title of the book and being like, oh, The Return to Vietnam, homegirl doesn't look very Vietnamese. She's so tall. Tallest Vietnamese I've ever seen. And I get that a lot. And so I think that one of the major motivating factors as to why I write is to answer questions on my own terms. And that first question is always, are you really Vietnamese? So I get this constant disavowal of my own identity, a story that's being told for me before I even get to open my lips. If they accept the possibility, the marginal, fractional possibility that I might actually be what I say I am, the next question they ask is, oh, was your dad a soldier? Which is a nice way of saying, is my mom a whore? Because if we've noticed through cinematic tellings of the history of the US-Vietnam War, the relationships between white men and Vietnamese women is largely focalized through the optics of a GI prostitute narrative. So the way that I answer that question is two-sided. The first of which is my grandparents. So my grandparents' story gives a little bit of truth to that question. And so here you see pictures of my grandparents. On the left is my grandmother, named after a lemon, even though she hated that name because she's like, no, I'm not sour, I'm sweet. I was like, bitch, you're sour as hell. She used to file her toenails to a point, okay? As Stephen mentioned, I've got some letters behind my name, MFA, PhD, met a lot of smart people, but my grandmother remains to this day the smartest, savviest woman I have ever met in my life. She could bring you to tears or bring you to laughter with just a twist of her language, just like that. On the right, you'll see my grandfather. This is not my mom's father, but he's the only grandfather that I know because when he was serving in the US Army, which he did from World War II through the Vietnam War, he met my grandmother, who some might call a bar girl. She would have called a dancer, but most of us would call a prostitute. And she did that for just as many years as my grandfather served in our armed forces. Now, I mention that to give truth to that GI prostitute narrative, not to reinforce the stereotype that we see in movies like Full Metal Jacket, you know, the me love you long time, me so horny, the hair flipping, the skirt lifting. That wasn't the case. They were two people who had gone through a lot, had found themselves in positions that they didn't necessarily want, but that brought them together. And they brought us here. By virtue of my grandfather's profession, they were able to flee Vietnam on a military plane, which saved my mother's life. And he was able to grant access to my uncles and all my other family members, who most of which were lucky enough to arrive in the United States. So I mentioned that to give some humanity behind that narrative. And to show the actual realities when someone like my grandmother is illiterate because of her circumstances in her country. But then there's another side to that story too, and another side to the answer to that question, was your father a soldier? And that's my parents, who have a very different story. So my parents, as you can see, that's my mom and that's my dad. It's funny, when I pulled this picture out of my grandmother's collection, actually, I showed it to my mom and I was like, look, mom, it's your wedding picture. And by the way, she was pregnant with me in this picture. Her first comment was, "Oh my God, your dad looks so racist." And I go, "Wow." And then she goes, "You know, like Tennessee?" I go, "I think so, yeah. Sorry, Dad, I love you. I know you're watching at home." But they met in the most boring way possible. They met at a post office in Huntington Beach, California. Ooh, should make a movie about that. But I mention this to diversify and confound that narrative that all multiracial Vietnamese, all children of the Vietnam War, are these second-class citizens. Because in Vietnam, mixed-race people who look like me, who look American, are rendered second-class citizens. They are essentially expendable life because they are a constant reminder of an invading force that took their women and birthed these children that had nowhere to go, many of whom died in orphanages. But my parents have a very different story, and that's why I'm in front of you today. But I'm always encountering that narrative that associates my life with mass death during the Vietnam War. And my mom has had to deal with that as well. She often tells people that I'm French instead of American because somehow that more distant colonial period is somehow more palatable to people. She also refused to go to Vietnam with me, I think largely in part so she wouldn't have to answer questions for who she was and what I was the product of. So that silence there, that refusal of my identity, is one of the main reasons that I write, to answer those questions on my own terms. Another reason that I write is to really resist a lot of the reductive mythologies, this model minority myth that gets applied to a lot of Vietnamese people under the umbrella of Asian, as if all Asian Americans are all the same. And you've seen it everywhere in those stereotypes of like, "Oh, you're Asian, you must be great at math. Can I copy off your test?" I was like, "If you would like a D+, go right ahead." And you know, there's a lot of representations of Asians as kind of the glasses-pushing, pencil-pushing kind of people. But all of that effaces the realities of the destruction, the displacement, and the inheritance of trauma that Vietnamese refugees and their descendants experience in particular, which is very distinct from many other Asian Americans' histories. One of my mentors at USC and a recent winner of the Pulitzer Prize in Fiction last year for The Sympathizer, Viet Thanh Nguyen, writes that all wars are fought twice, the first time on the battlefield and the second time in memory. And I think that truth resonates with my family because the memories that we have, that I grapple with, that three generations now grapple with here in the U.S., shows that the U.S. war in Vietnam didn't end with that last battle. It continues to be fought on a daily basis. And that goes from mental health issues, the psychological struggle of grappling and continually bearing witness to those traumas, but also in socioeconomic issues. So you'll see me up there on the right-hand side with my dirty-ass feet. That's not something that's cute for the picture. That's because I was poor, really, really poor. So I grew up with my mom in a housing project in L.A., and so I knew hunger very many times, learned how to jimmy into canned food to get through the day. And of course, I dealt with my mom's what I think a lot of people would use the term maybe post-traumatic stress disorder, though I kind of resist those clinical terms that try to reduce an experience that is really diverse in its manifestations for everyone who's encountered trauma. And her PTSD, I'll just use it for shorthand, has really manifested in a mutability of memory and a repetition, a constant repetition. So I've heard the same story so many times with ever so slight changes, going with that mutability, that mercurial sort of memory, so much so that by the time I went back to Vietnam, and I always say went back, but even though it was my first time, the book recounts my first time to Vietnam, but it felt like going back because I knew the country so well just from hearing it over and over and over again from my mother. And my grandmother, on the other hand, was a little bit silent about it. She would just kind of joke about things. And so there were a lot of empty spaces that I had to fill in. And part of that curiosity drove me to go to Vietnam to understand where she was from and what we were about and why I am the way I am. And guaranteed, as soon as I got off the plane, jumped into that first taxi cab, the guy was smoking a cigarette, had his pinky up his other nostril somehow, and then was up on the sidewalk driving us to the hotel. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's the way I am. That's totally why I am the way I am. So there, it was a certain homecoming. So it really speaks to that power of memory that I may be the first American-born child in my whole family, but Vietnam and all of its histories, happy, sad, and everything in between, is very much a part of me. So when the U.S. propagates these narratives that refugees should be grateful for being here, that they're lucky to even enter our borders, especially with Vietnamese refugees in particular, that we're doing fine because, you know, Asians, they're doing well, no problem. That's not necessarily true, because we're carrying all of that, all of the reasons why we're here to begin with, that war. What, if you look at the body count between 3 and 4 million, which our US textbooks won't tell me, or won't tell us as Americans, that could be considered a genocide in its own way when we look at the aerial warfare, the chemicals that were dropped, but it's referred to as a war, and somehow that silences things. One other of the last reasons that I write is to really blur time and space, because Vietnam is not just some otherworldly place, and it's not separate from America. There's an ocean that connects us, and I really emphasize the ocean. I feel like we live in that ocean of memory. And this is a picture from my wedding last year, my parents, and this is a traditional Vietnamese áo dài that I'm wearing, which a lot of people talked a lot of smack about because they're like, green and yellow for a wedding, gross. But it was my great-grandmother's favorite colors, and she always wore them, so even though I never met her physically, she never had the chance to come to America, I feel like she lives with me, and so I wanted to have her colors on. And when we blur time and space, and as the chapters in my book, they oscillate between Vietnam and the U.S. to really blur those spatio-temporal constructs that suggest that somehow we're progressing and leaving things behind and we're separate and borders make us distinct. I think this really speaks to the fact that we are here, that in national rhetoric today, we hear refugee is a very scary and fear-inducing word. But this is also what refugees look like. And we're here, and we're home, and we have stories to tell. And to further humanize refugees, I'll draw your attention to the role of humor in my life and my writing. There are some glamorous family photos from my collection. You see my grandma there in the middle, two pictures, posing. She had a tradition of always acting silly in front of the camera, and clearly all of us in the family have picked up that tradition and carried it proudly. I really can't stand in front of a camera without doing something, you know? And that's really one way that I've grappled with it. In the book, you'll see there's like pictures of me on the toilet, so I didn't study marketing. I hope that helps you want to read the book. I'm little in it. I'm like 4. It's not like yesterday or anything. So we need to remember that when we apply words like refugee or genocide or war, that there are human beings with senses of humor behind all of that. And lastly, I'll end on this. I would like to dedicate this, as I do with everything, including my book, for my grandmother, for my Bang Wai, which means maternal grandmother in Vietnamese. Here are two of the last pictures that I have of her before she passed away. But I would also like to dedicate it to the daughter who is in my belly. I'm about 6 months pregnant. Yeah, you know, people get happy and you're like, baby, and they're like, oh my God, you're a good person. I'm like, no. Yeah, my soon-to-be daughter, Vivian, and if her and my grandmother could meet, I think that they would get along very well. I don't have a picture of Vivian that doesn't look science fictional, but if you need a visual. You know, blurring time and space, Bringing past and present and future together keeps us alive, keeps us united. And I'll just end with a quote from James Baldwin, who is amazing in his beautiful use of words. And part of this quote is emblazoned on the wonderful other museum on the other side of the National Mall here. But James Baldwin wrote, "History is present in all that we do." Thank you.
Thank you, Jade. Next is Suzanne Reisman, author of This Eden Called Warsaw. Suzanne earned an MFA in creative writing from the New School. She is also the recipient of several awards for her writing. She's the author of a travelogue, Off the Beaten Subway Path, New York City's Best Unusual Attractions. Suzanne, please.
Hi. Thank you for having me. It is a huge honor to be here. I'm very excited to talk about my book. I'm vaguely annoyed that I have to follow Jade. That's a very, very hard act, but I'll do my best. You know, when I was growing up, I spent a lot of time with my grandfather, especially on weekends. And my parents, great, worked on weekends, and my grandmother worked on weekends, my grandmother, who I call Bubby. And so the person who cared for my sister and I was my grandfather. And you can see from this picture that even at the ripe old age of approximately 2, I was very busy trying to write my grandfather's story, which was very challenging because what I knew, even though he was very kind and generous and loving and would do anything for my sister and I, was that he would never talk about his past. I knew that he grew up, he was born in Warsaw, and that he had a large, probably Orthodox or Hasidic family, and that when Warsaw fell to the Nazis in 1939, I had been told that his mother and his sisters begged him to leave, that they said that he, as a man, his life was in danger, but that women, they felt like women would be safe, women and children, that they weren't going to get hurt, and they couldn't risk going out with him as refugees. It was very dangerous. So they urged him to leave by himself. And that was all I knew. And we were told in uncertain terms, never ask Grandpa to talk about his family. Don't bring it up. I was in a Sunday school program where they did do a Yom HaShoah Memorial Day thing once, and they said, go talk to your grandparents about it, and I did break that rule, and there was immediate kibosh that we were just, and I never brought it up again. So even though I spent a lot of time with him, there was this mystery, this mystique of who these people were and who they meant, what they meant to him, that he could never talk about them again. The next picture. So my grandfather actually passed away in 1995. I was 19, I was away in college, and when he passed away, he took those secrets with him. He basically took everybody's names, the names of their children, their livelihoods, and at the time, I was busy with college, and I didn't really think about it, but years later, I was in a writing class, and we were given an exercise to write 2 pages about something you never told anyone, and immediately, my brain flipped to something my grandmother never told, and that was about his family, and I started writing about that, and I started trying to think about who they were, and this was 2008, so he'd already been passed away for a very long time, but I actually started to get very angry at him. And on one hand, what is it my business? Who am I to tell somebody how to grieve and how to cope with an enormous loss like that? A loss that I could only begin to fathom. But on the other hand, I felt it was in a way very selfish and unfair to the people who died, that their memories, he was one person who lived who could pass on the memories, and there were so many families who everyone perished and they had nobody to pass on their family stories, and how could he not share that with people? And it felt very wrong to me. And it felt like he was robbing them of their voices and of their importance, and I thought I would really like to try to do something about that. I would like to give them their place back in history. And so I started on a nonfiction project where I had this big goal. I was going to do all this research. I was going to find out who they were. I was going to write this book. It was going to be sort of like That book, The Lost, my search for six and 6 million, and it was gonna be this journey around the world, and I was gonna meet all these people. And the reality of it is actually that it's very hard to find out about people in Warsaw particularly. The entire city had been, well, the Jewish portion of the city was destroyed in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising in 1943, literally burned to the rubble. And then the almost 85% of the Warsaw was destroyed in 1944 in the Warsaw Uprising, and that included the general archives. So there were really no records of my family. There's no record my grandfather even existed, which set off a whole other existential crisis in my life of like, oh my God, there's no evidence of this person, but he really, I'm here, so he must have existed. The nonfiction was not terribly compelling. Just every time I'd start to write about people, I'd come to an end point where it was like, well, what happened next? And I'd always be like, well, I don't know. And what came of that, though, is I went through an MFA program, and I did write a thesis about it. And the thesis was actually about refugees in general. Both my grandparents who had been refugees, like I said, my grandfather had fled from Warsaw and he went to Russia. And in Russia, he met my bubby, who was also a refugee. She was born in Belarus. And when the Nazis invaded the Soviet Union, my bubby was evacuated. And they wound up, the very long story short is they wound up meeting in the Ural Mountains and they got married and my dad was born there. And so I spent a lot of time thinking about refugees and about people who are looking for safe harbor and what you would do to find a place to call home and what did it mean to call home, especially because my grandfather, who ultimately learned that his whole family had perished, that's what I had been told, he was the only survivor in his family. And then my bubby, who was able to leave the Soviet Union at the end of the war in 1946, when my grandfather was repatriated to Poland, well, she left her family behind in Belarus, and she never saw her parents again. She had a brother and a sister, and she did see her brother 40 years later. And then he went back to Belarus, and he died. And so, again, it was sort of like, how do you capture the voices of people who have been lost? Can I get to the third picture of the guy with the beard and the hat? Thanks. So I'd started writing nonfiction. I wrote this thesis. It became a chapbook that won a contest at the New School. If you are interested, there are some copies out in the hallway. It's free, so that's easy. And I was talking about it after I won the chapbook contest about what to do next, and I was talking with a friend of mine from the New School, and she was a fiction student, and she said, well, I think you need to write this as a novel. And I was like, ha, 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 I can't write a novel. I don't know how to write a novel. But I thought more and more about it, and if the central, the most important premise to me was not to lose these people's places in history and to capture a memory of them, then maybe a novel did make sense, and I could take all the research that I had and all the things that I had learned, and I could create stories around them. And that led me to do more research about Warsaw in general and the Warsaw Jewish community at that time, which was the largest Jewish community in Europe. It's the second largest Jewish community in the world behind New York. In 1939, there were about 350,000 Jewish people living there. And at the end of the war, there were 3,500 left. And so it became more than just the voices of my own family, but the enormous loss of this vibrant, dynamic, amazing Jewish community that, as I researched more and more, was finding out was nothing like the preconceptions. And Jade talked a lot about people's preconceptions. And my preconception is everyone looked like this. This happens to me, my great uncle, who is my grandfather's brother-in-law, who did, in fact, wind up surviving the war and is a character in the book. And so wanting to place people in context and representing the entire spectrum of vibrant Jewish life became also an important tenet of it. But at the same time, it became even scarier because now I'm using people's real names, but I'm making up stories about them completely. And I didn't want to dishonor their memory. Like, what if I got it wrong? What if they weren't like that at all? What if they were alive and they looked at it and they said I was disgracing them? And it was a huge fear that I had. It was really hard to get started on the writing of the novel because I had to get over that. I had to get over the fact that I was making things up. And every time I made up a last name for somebody or a child that they had, it was like, well, I don't know. And I was like, but it doesn't matter. It's a novel. It doesn't matter if it's real. As long as it feels real and as long as I'm trying to honor their spirit, I think it's okay. And so The nonfiction part took me 3 years. The fiction part took me another 3 years, plus years of revision, and I was looking for an agent for a very long time. And I'm proud to say that finally I have one, and so the book is going to go, The Seed Called Warsaw is going to go on submission to publishers soon, so you won't be able to buy it with everybody else's wonderful books today, but hopefully you'll be seeing it soon on bookshelves. And then if we could get the last picture. So this was actually my grandfather's last place of residence in Warsaw, and it's from the archives. It doesn't exist today. I've been to Warsaw. I've stood on that spot. It's a vacant lot. It was probably, he didn't live in the Jewish community when he was growing up. He lived just outside the borders, and it was probably destroyed during the Warsaw Uprising. But it makes me think very hard about, like, this point of the book, which is trying to talk about people's lives and how deeply rooted they were in the community, which sort of is a play also on the title, This Eden Called Warsaw, because Eden is obviously a garden, and people had very deep roots there, and Adam and Eve were expelled from the garden against their will, and that's how I feel that the Jews of Warsaw were expelled, and the ones who survived, their roots were completely pulled out, and they were left without home, without family, without anything to ground them. And when I think about that today, I think Rachel talked a little bit, and Jade talked about the Syrian refugees and the things that are happening with them, and the idea that you're getting uprooted. People don't just leave because, oh, you know, a boat ride sounds cool, or like, why don't I just go through the forest while people are shooting at me, and hopefully I'll wind up in Russia and it'll be all right. You leave because you're forced to. And that leaves a deep imprint on you, and it leaves a deep imprint on the people who are in your life, especially if you don't talk about it, because all it leaves for you is imagination. And so that's sort of the genesis of This Eden Called Warsaw, and I really do hope that I did my family honor and that I did the Warsaw Jewish community honor in writing that, and I thank you for listening. So.
Thank you, Suzanne. Next, we welcome Meline Toumani, author of There Was and There Was Not, A Journey Through Hate and Possibility in Turkey, Armenia, and Beyond. It was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award and the Dayton Literary Peace Prize. Meline contributes to the New York Times, Harper's, the Boston Globe, and several other publications. Meline, please.
Good evening, everyone. It's an honor to be here. I thought I would start by talking a little bit about the title of my book, which could be interpreted in a few different ways. And telling you a little bit about that will help me explain to you what motivated me to write this book. There was and there was not. Well, if you know anything about the Armenian genocide of 1915, you probably know that Turkey has never actually acknowledged that what happened to the Armenians was a genocide. And you may know that, in fact, it's sort of a cornerstone of Turkish policy and has been for decades to combat the idea that there was an Armenian genocide in all sorts of forums, whether through academic institutions or media organizations or official recognition by governments around the world. At the same time, for Armenians all over the world, particularly the Armenian diaspora in the United States, fighting for recognition of the Armenian genocide is a kind of central primary feature of community life. You might say it's a raison d'etre for the community to fight for recognition of the genocide, again, in official contexts, governmental resolutions, school curricula, any sorts of representation. So when you think of there was and there was not, maybe the most obvious first level meaning might be there was a genocide, there wasn't a genocide. You have these clashing narratives. If you know a little more about the issue, you might be able to think of there was and there was not as talking about the fact that there was an Armenian civilization thriving in Anatolia for thousands of years, and then there was not. You can go today and see that there are ruins of Armenian churches dotting the hillsides of southeastern Turkey, like exhibits in an open-air museum, where there used to be, you know, 2 million Ottoman Armenians. Now you have about 50,000 Armenians living in Turkey today. So on that level, there was and there was not. There were Armenians there, now there are not. But neither of those are actually the sort of spirit of why I chose this title for my book. What it meant for me is something that any Armenians and Turks in the audience might immediately recognize. There was and there was not is the way that you start a folktale or a story in both languages, in Armenian and in Turkish. So in Armenian, it's garçkar. In Turkish, it's bir varmış bir yokmuş. And it's sort of a way of saying, once upon a time, there was and also there was not, a long time ago, far away, in a village, dot, dot, dot. This is how you begin a story. As a child, I found this to be a very, very strange and kind of frustrating way to hear a story. Well, was there or wasn't there? You know, what does that mean, there was and there was not? It immediately puts you in a sort of confused and uncomfortable position. Well, when you think about this with regard to the history of the Armenian Genocide, it's impossible not to think about the way that Turkey's attempts to sort of rewrite this history have created that kind of an unstable narrative, have created that sense of confusion, have created that sense of frustration for somebody trying to understand what happened. I'm going to get back to that in a second. So to talk about my personal story for a moment, I'm not a descendant of a genocide survivor. My family was not directly affected by the Armenian Genocide. That took place in the Ottoman Empire in what is now Turkey, and my family was in the Caucasus and in Iran, where Armenians have also lived for centuries and continue to live. And nonetheless, even without this being a part of my immediate family story, somehow I grew up in the Armenian community, specifically in New Jersey, feeling that this was a central feature of my identity. I mean, it was a part of everything we did, everything we talked about as a community. It seemed that no matter what kind of an event, whether it was a literary event or a concert or a lecture or, you know, even a sporting event or anything, somehow there was a connection to the genocide, to the campaign for genocide recognition, to all of this. And so it became very central to my sense of what it is to be Armenian. Now, what's inextricable from that is that the idea of Turkey as my enemy sort of took root in my mind. It was there as long as I can remember. I can't think of a time that I didn't have that feeling. And as a child, you know, already I sort of understood, you know, we don't buy Turkish products and we don't talk about Turkish coffee, it's Armenian coffee, and, you know, all of these little ways in which I understood, you know, it's us against them. Now, in the community, in the conversation about the genocide, it was always about this concept of fighting Turkish denial, and so that brings us back to this problem of there was and there was not, of this unstable narrative that had evolved over time. And as I grew up, as I got older, as I sort of came of age intellectually and sort of started to think of myself as a writer, this started to feel just sort of ridiculous to me. And I'll give you a little example of an anecdote that I always think back to. I was in college at UC Berkeley, and we had I was a part of the Armenian Students Association there, and we were hosting a reading by the Armenian writer Peter Balakian, a very well-known writer, and I was very excited about it. I was an English major, and, you know, it was something with a writer. It wasn't, you know, going to be just about history or whatever, politics. So he read his poems, and it was nice and all of that, and then the very first question when he finished was, from one of my classmates in the Armenian Students Association, how do you think poetry can be used to combat genocide denial? Excuse me. I found the question so depressing. I felt like at that moment, I had just had enough. I thought, is there any part of our life as a community that isn't sort of colonized by this topic? Is there any part of the Armenian imagination that can be somehow liberated from this, not just from the topic, but from the need to uphold a certain agenda and narrative and to accomplish something, which is to make sure everybody knows about the genocide and knows about it in a very clear way so that there is no question and that we're, you know, we've got a strong stronghold against the power of Turkish denial and all of this. And I just couldn't take it anymore. I felt like this has become like a straitjacket. Now, how does that relate to writing? Well, very directly, as it turns out. You know, I mentioned I was starting to think of myself as a writer, and as I, you know, moved on, became a journalist, was in graduate school in New York in a writing program, I started to think about the way that when, let's say you're writing a novel, sometimes you'll hear a novelist say, I didn't know what my characters were going to do until they did it. Or, you know, I didn't know how the story was going to end until it happened. And you think, well, how can that be? You know, you're the one writing it. Well, it gets to a very deep question about what happens when you create art. And I'd like to think that what happens is a process of discovery. And it's a process of discovery that requires you to be totally free of an agenda and totally free of this kind of burden, the sense that you must make sure that by the end this thing is clear. And that was how I had started to feel about writing about the Armenian Genocide. I felt like there was memoir after memoir after memoir, and they all told these very tragic, very vivid stories, but somehow it was as if there was no other way to talk about it. There was no other possibility, and that wasn't just about writing either. It was about the way we were evolving as a community and the way academic work was taking shape on the subject. Everybody was kind of held hostage to this, to what I call this sort of straitjacket problem, which of course was a very direct byproduct of Turkey's, you know, lack of reckoning with the issue. But nonetheless, you know, you can blame it on how, you know, you can explain it, but the fact is I felt that the community was suffering, and I felt that I personally, as a writer, felt really constricted. So then what happened? I'm gonna skip over a lot of things because there's too much to explain from how I got from here to there, but thinking back to that issue again of there was and there was not, and this unstable narrative, I thought, okay, we have this bizarre war over the historical record, you know, between, you know, Armenians and Turks trying to fight for airtime on this issue. We can't change that. That's not going anywhere. It's as if we're two people shouting at each other, yes, you did, no, I didn't, yes, you did, no, I didn't, and it's just not changing. So what can happen? I started to think about this idea of denial, which had been just this word with a capital D in my head all my life. What if instead of fighting it, sort of entered into it? What would that mean? And so I started thinking about this. What could sort of go be, what if we started from that clash of narratives, took it as a sort of, this is where we are, where do we go from here? Okay, how do we progress? How can we make some kind of, you know, forward motion? Is there some kind of reconciliation possible? What would that look like? So basically, I started to envision this book. This is where I'm really gonna fast forward because I know I've already taken too much time. One thing led to another, I moved to Turkey. I lived there for 2.5 years. I went there with this idea that if I could talk to people, if I could listen to them, if I could ask them how they learned about the genocide, what did it mean to them to hear about this thing? And of course, I would be careful about what words I used and how I talked about it. And if I could just somehow find some kind of empathy, even for somebody saying something that I just vehemently disagreed with, could I bring back some kind of story that would open a window, maybe make Armenians see Turks differently? Maybe I, as this sort of like what I imagined myself to be, this uber diplomatic Armenian, maybe I could make a difference in the person listening to me and the person I was talking to there. At the time, and in the book proposal that I sold to a publisher more than 10 years ago, I called it a literary act of diplomacy. I envisioned that this book was going to do all of these grand things. Once again, skipping over a lot of things that happened, it didn't work. I got there, I was there, I had these conversations. I couldn't take it. I couldn't find that magical way to connect. I couldn't really sit through those conversations with that kind of empathy that I hoped I would have. It was actually a lot worse and a lot harder than I thought it would be. Turkish politics and history and all of that was far more complex than I had ever imagined. And I came home feeling totally stuck and thinking, I don't want to write another book that's just an Armenian criticizing Turkey. I don't want to do that. That wasn't what I wanted to do. So what do I do? Well, the truth is, one part that I can't leave out because it's very important, by the time I had lived in Turkey for 2.5 years, I felt like I was on the verge of losing my mind, and that's because I had worked so hard to be sort of tolerable to people that I was speaking with who didn't accept that what had happened to the Armenians had been a genocide. I had tried so hard to be kind of compromising and all of that to just get through those conversations, and I really was kind of losing myself, losing track of you know, my own center. Couldn't write the book I wanted to write. Ended up writing a book about all of this, the entire journey from childhood, my sort of childhood nationalism, through my coming of age years, through my sort of budding fascination with Turkey and the kind of, on the one hand, enchantment that I found there, on the other hand, like, you know, real difficulties I faced trying to talk to people and connect and find some form of reconciliation that didn't depend on agreeing about 1915. So I ended up telling a book that told that entire story. And in doing so, I had to ask myself, what did I think I was doing? Why did I think I could do this thing? Why did I think that somehow I was gonna, you know, find some magic solution? I won't get into all of what I discovered, but that's what's in the book. And so that answers the first part of what motivated me to write this. But the second part of the question was, how are these themes, how do you hope that these themes will be universal or, you know, relevant to people in the future? Really, what I learned in the end was that I wasn't writing a book about the Armenian genocide or about Armenia or about Turkey. It was about what it means to belong to a community, what it means to feel the desire to belong, but also the desire to break away and somehow separate yourself and have some sort of individuation. I think that's a very universal issue that people face, especially people who have that kind of ethnic community or religious community life. So that tension between belonging and individuation is a big one. And the other big theme that I think is really universal is that everybody has an other, whoever that other is for them. For me, it was the Turk, and I had to sort of, I had to explore that. I had to take that on. I don't think I fully explained the full sort of spectrum of what that became for me, because there was a lot of love and a lot of, you know, connection that I did feel once I became immersed in that culture. It's too complicated to explain that alongside all of the frustration and real challenges of dealing with the genocide issue. But it's about finding who that other is for you, for anyone. Everybody has that person, and seeing how far you can go in not only understanding the other, but also understanding what kind of biases you yourself have started with. And I just think there's a lot of value, you know, more than ever these days, in those universal themes. So, thank you.
Thank you, Maline. Finally, we welcome Sarah Wildman, author of Paper Love, Searching for the Girl My Grandfather Left Behind. Sarah's received numerous grants and competitive fellowships for her writing. She's contributed to the New York Times, The New Yorker Online, Slate, Washingtonian, and The Washington Post, among others. Sarah is currently foreign policy correspondent for Vox. Sarah.
Thank you, and thanks for staying for me. I appreciate you being here and the museum for hosting this panel of really interesting women, and it's kind of great that it's all women, I have to say. So we're back to the Holocaust with my book. And actually, through my whole life, I had this sense of being an accidental American, that it was arbitrary that I spoke English, that it was strange that I was here at all, entirely because I knew from a very young age, from basically the moment I can remember memory, that I was who I was because of the European Jewish apocalypse. And I became who I am because of that. But I also knew that my grandfather had escaped with everyone, that he had a miraculous escape, that it was perfect, it was clean, and it was a narrative of luck and daring and intrigue, but that it had all worked out well. And that's something that's really easy to absorb as a kid, because who he left with was his mother and sister. And as a child, that is your world. Your immediate world is your nuclear family. And so I didn't push back against that, that to understand what it meant to be a refugee was not to leave with one's nuclear family. But sometime after my grandfather's death, I was at my grandparents' home. My grandmother was still living. And I was rooting around in a cabinet, and I came across an album of the kind that people used to use with little black photo corners. And it showed sort of wonderful pictures of 20-somethings in antique bathing costumes, but otherwise looking very modern. And there was a picture in the back, a small folded note. And in each quadrant of the note, so actually let's go past one more. In each quadrant of the note was a girl who had taken it of herself, a sort of selfie, if you will. And under each a caption, you know, will Carl write to me today? Oh, no letter, maybe tomorrow. And it was dated May of 39 and Dateline Czechoslovakia. And I showed it to my grandmother and she said, oh, that was your grandfather's true love. And she didn't say anything further. So I called that sister that had escaped with him, and I said, who is the true love, and what is this, and what's this album, and who are these people? And she said, the woman's name was Valerie Scheftel. She was a doctor. She'd come to study medicine and had met my grandfather at the University of Vienna, where he was a student. She'd fallen in love with him immediately, and he had ignored her. And then one summer, he realized he was in love with her, too, and he raced to tell her, and they had a whirlwind romance, and they planned to escape together. But instead, he escaped with the people I knew he'd escaped with, his mother and sister. And she typed a letter, she sent it to my office, and sent, I was at the New Republic then, and she said, why don't you find out what happened to her? I've always wondered. And in the background of that letter was basically an idea, why don't you find out about everyone else that has been left out of the narrative? Because what I discovered over time was that it wasn't just Vali left behind, but a half-brother and nieces and nephews, and the whole world that one lives within, because we don't live in units of our nuclear family. We have coworkers or colleagues, or we have students that we go to school with, we have cousins. But when my aunt sent me that letter, I thought, well, what can I do with this? Even though I've grown up with this, there's so much that happens within the narrative of a Holocaust refugee family where we collapse the time, where it becomes a story we repeat by rote about Kristallnacht, maybe we started Anschluss like my family does, Anschluss, Kristallnacht, a yellow star, and then Auschwitz, and then survival or murder. So I thought, I can't do more than this. I know there are so many names, I can't do more than this, but I started wondering, what if we pulled apart that accordion of time and started looking at what it meant to live through those years, what it meant for an entire group of people to be disentangled from normal life, one restriction after another, not all at once, but one tiny moment after another. And this started for me a little bit, this sense of what it meant to erase these individuals, this kind of obsession I began to look into of erasure, because I came across a story of three forgotten slave labor camps in the heart of Paris. One was near the Champs-Élysées, one in the 10th arrondissement, and one near the Austerlitz train station. And they were tasked with sorting and redistributing the goods of all the regular people who were being deported, all the Sarah Wildmans, who weren't owners of Renoirs, but who had things like china, maybe, or a crib. And all of those things, those pots and pans, and all those things were gathered and taken to these depots where they were collected by slave Jews to be resent into the Reich if they were reusable for bomb victims. And everything that they found that were personal, they were told to burn. to erase them further. And after I wrote a story about that and became sort of obsessed with this idea of pursuing these stories that were not seen as necessary in the first tellings of this historiography, which was necessarily focused immediately upon the major camps and the major deportations, after that I actually came here to the museum for a quiet conversation about an archive that no one had ever gone into as a journalist, as an academic, called the International Tracing Service. And I became a little bit obsessed with the idea of getting into this archive, which was supposed to have all kinds of answers to questions we didn't even know how to ask because of Vali. Because around this time, I came across a group of letters. I was rooting around in my parents' basement. I had been living in Madrid at that point, and I came back, and I was sort of bored in the way that you do when you're home and you're, you know, at your parents, and it's midnight. And I came across a box labeled patient correspondence. It was sort of tucked inside another box. And it was filled with packs of letters that disintegrated. Their rubber bands disintegrated when I touched them. And they clearly hadn't been looked at in decades. And there were letters and letters and letters from his entire exploded Viennese world, from everyone we had never been spoken of, and dozens and dozens and dozens of letters from this woman. So with these in hand, and with the fact that the archives in the International Tracing Service opened finally that summer, I set out to try to see if I could grandiosely unerase someone. Could I tell a story that hadn't been told, that had been cut out of the narrative of my own family, and certainly out of the narrative of the greater story of the Holocaust? And within that, I also carried my own secret, like Jade, which was that when I set out in search of this woman, I was newly pregnant with my first child, and so I had this sense the entire time that I was growing a little Jew in pursuit of a lost Jew. And what did that mean? What did it mean to be doing that sort of subversively? And how did I incorporate that narrative, or did I? And was that even worth writing about? Was my trials and tribulations of dealing with having, I then ended up moving to Berlin for a while, of having a German OB and having this weird cultural, where they don't, you know, cry in the street in Germany the way that you might hear because of random news and people thought it was bizarre that I was alone and wandering around, and, you know, what was I doing there? And sometimes I question the same thing, you know, what was I doing there? Why did this still matter so much? But part of it became this incredible responsibility that suddenly felt like it had descended upon me, which was that Vali's story allowed me into that accordion I mentioned before, to peel back those moments that we don't think about, even those of us who grew up, as I did, with people who'd been on a kinder transport at my Shabbat dinner table, you know, who had never seen their mother again weeping as they say pass the salt. Even for me, Vali's story opened something else up, because I understood that what it meant for her to go from Vienna back to Czechoslovakia, which she does, which seems so counterintuitive and ridiculous to me, is because she doesn't know what I know. I had to constantly remind myself, she returns to Czechoslovakia to her mother because she doesn't know the Sudetenland is about to be handed over. And then she moves to Berlin, where in June of 1940, she's forced to live in a Judenhäuser, which were these apartment-sized ghettos, where 10 or 15 people were suddenly forced to live cheek by jowl alongside their neighbors, who they may or may not have known, in apartments that had once housed two. Throughout, she writes to my grandfather, and she doesn't mention any of this. She doesn't tell him as 39 becomes 40, she's no longer allowed to buy clothes or shoes, or as 40 becomes 41, that she's no longer allowed to resole those shoes. She doesn't tell him that restriction by restriction mount, that they come in tiny moments. First it's tea, and then it's coffee, and then it's coffee, and then it's jam, and then it's meat, and then it's milk, and that she stands online for an hour each day to be able to buy her food, and if she gets to the front of the line, if the hour is over, she can no longer purchase it. She doesn't tell him in February of 1940, that the Jews of the town of Stettin in the Baltic seaport had been brutally rounded up. She doesn't need to tell him, because other people start to write him and tell him these things. And they say to him, you have to get her out. It may be difficult. You can find her an illegal visa to go to Chile. It looks really good. All you need is $150 per person. And so I decided to find out what my grandfather was doing. What were you doing then that you couldn't hand her $150? I understand it's not our $150, but what were you doing? And so then I dove headfirst into what was happening for the German-speaking refugees in this country at that moment. My grandfather came as a physician, but the AMA was actively lobbying against refugee physicians from being licensed from state to state so that by 1943, there were only two states left that would license refugee physicians. And he was placed in Massachusetts, even though he wanted to be in New York, because the National Committee for the Resettlement of Foreign Physicians looked for rural areas which could accommodate physicians because they had a need. And they kept a file on him that I found at the University of Minnesota, a 50-page document, a series of documents, where they used him as a case study because he was so impoverished when he arrived here that by the time he receives this letter that he can buy these visas that may or may not work, his mother has sold the last of her jewelry, netting her $60, and he cannot afford his rent, which is $5. So $150 might have been a million for him, and still he lives with this and doesn't convey it to any of us. But in the summer of 41, she writes to him, and she says, "A long, long time ago, you wrote to me from Vienna when I was supposed to go to Prague, that one should not be so small-minded to sacrifice the present to the phantom of the future. You wrote these words in a completely different context at the time, but you were so right then. And maybe that's your thinking now as well. Maybe you are right not wanting to sacrifice your present to the past or to the future. It is, however, so terribly sad for me because I live almost without a present and I can live only for the past and for the future." She writes this. Her affidavit has come through, her visa number has come through, her quota has come due, but the State Department that summer decided they would no longer let in any refugees who were leaving behind family members, that they would be perceived as a threat to American society, that they would be perceived as spies, potential fifth columnists. And on the floor of the Senate in June of 41, the senator from North Carolina, Robert Reynolds, said, "I wish to say that if I had my way about it at this hour, I would today build a wall around the United States so high and so secure, not a single alien or foreign refugee from any country upon the face of this earth could scale or ascend it." So it was within this context that I wrote about this woman, about what she could tell us about what it meant to be someone for whom Judaism was the color of her walls, but it didn't affect the texture of her day, let alone her week or her year, but she's reduced to a singular identity. Everything is taken from her, even as she clings desperately both to the idea of her professionalism, her intellectualism, her sense of self, and her desire to see my grandfather again. And I clung to this idea that if I could maybe tell her story and do it some justice, that I might allow us some tactile relationship to what it meant to live through this period and what it might mean to be a refugee. And I don't know if I did it justice, but that was the effort that I made. And it drove me, because once I found her letters, and once I found that in the ITS, and maybe this will inspire you to buy, someone else was looking for her, and what that meant, and that we don't live as atoms bouncing around the world, that we are interconnected in different ways with people in ways we might not expect, that I thought that for those little Jews I grew as I went in pursuit of a lost Jew, I needed to tell this story, both to have a tactile relationship to the past, but also to understand our present. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Beg your pardon. I'd like to thank all of our authors for their very thought-provoking words. I'd also like to ask you to join me on the stage for Q&A. I will begin Q&A with just a couple of questions to our authors, and then we'll turn it over to you here in the audience, as well as those watching via webcast. You can pose your questions to Facebook and Twitter via the hashtag memorytransferred. I do ask that you keep your questions concise, and please, our authors have come from all over the United States, taken some very valuable time to be here with us. Please make certain your questions are formulated as questions. Thank you all. First question, what common threads do you see in each other's work and perhaps the work of other contemporaries?
Okay, I'll start with that one because I have really taken a strong interest in the work, especially by grandchildren of refugees and survivors from Nazism, from the Holocaust. And so I've now read books by everybody on this panel. I have actually had the great pleasure of reading Suzanne's manuscript, and if there are any publishers, you know, listening out there, please get in touch with Suzanne's agent.
Thank you.
Yes. But in part I've done that because I do have a sense of identity with them, and there's something about, I should say there's both identity and there's learning more from it. For instance, with Sarah's work, with Paper Love as I read it, there were so many things that I identified with, but at the same time, my views were broadened and deepened because of what you did with the accordion, in a sense. You know, for the people who were left behind, I didn't have a sense of the day-to-day struggles before I read your book. Just the way that you described the gradual restrictions, each new thing being leveled on Valley was really helpful. But at the same time, I already felt a sort of bond with you and your grandfather's experience, with my grandparents' experience, so something like that. I think that there's also something about being of a certain age and having the intervening generation. There was this time where I think people were very busy and very focused on day-to-day life, and you didn't just sort of sit around dinner and say, hey, let's talk about, you know, when you were back in Germany or back in Poland or whatever. But I think that for more and more writers of our generation, in part, I think with some of the elders realizing that time is running out, there's been more of a willingness to talk, and the relationship is different. There is a sense in which I think that answering questions from your grandchildren can be just a different experience. Again, everyone's experiences are different. We heard from Suzanne that her grandfather really didn't speak of things. I could talk about things with each writer up here that I have in common, but I'll stop. So.
And I think it's interesting because people talked a lot about erasure and what happens when you're erased, and then how pernicious stereotypes and generalities can replace that, and how by writing about, to put people back who've been erased, how you overcome generalizations or inaccuracies or tropes or stereotypes that have been allowed to persist in that vacuum. It's really important to make sure that doesn't happen.
Secondly, both Holocaust revisionism and outright denial are very real problems. Have any of you experienced that kind of attack on your writing? And what is the best way, do you think, to combat that attack on memory?
I have actually not experienced that, but I'll tell you a story of the reverse, which was that about a year ago, I received a Twitter message from an Egyptian who said that mine was the first book on the Holocaust he'd ever read, which I thought was mind-boggling, because why me? And he had just randomly heard me on the radio and picked it up. And he asked, what else can I recommend? Because I'd like to tell people about it, and I'd like to recommend further. And I said, well, what drew you to this? Why did you pick it up? And he said, because it was a story about a person, and I really related to her. And I think that to me was a really remarkable moment. I mean, clearly this was not somebody who was a Holocaust denialist, but the fact that this, you know, why does anyone pick up any book? I mean, I think that this is a question for all of us, right? There are a lot of books, there's a lot of distraction now. I mean, we're all distracted by our devices in addition to, you know, potentially fake news and alt news sites and things like that. But how do we break through? And I think for all of us on this panel, I think that each of us has a personal story to tell. And I mean, even more so now listening to everybody, but there's something about being able to draw a direct line between past and present, not just between Holocaust stories and the present, but also between the Vietnam War and the present. I mean, the ways in which these past traumas and the Armenian genocide, I mean, each of these things has shaped us and shaped our work. And I think that that personal relationship to the past allows people now to sort of take a moment out of their busy, distracted day and think, why might I see myself in this narrative? And that seems like a piece of the puzzle.
To jump off what Sarah said, I think, you know, living in this culture of alternative facts now, there seems, and with social media and everything, there seems to be this inclination to just say no to people, to put something out there and say, no, it was this way. And that's very scary for us because I think that we're, what we all share in common, to go back to the first question too, is this resistance against forgetting. And I know in my daily life, that's me putting post-its everywhere, like I'm in CSI or something, trying to connect the dots. But it's also to not lose the truths of our personal stories, you know, in this culture in which things are blatantly erased and denied and twisted into things that really deny the people who are experiencing them. So I think that that's, you know, I haven't experienced a denial of the Vietnam War, especially if you read our counterinsurgency manuals that our military reads today, every soldier has to read it. The Vietnam War is mentioned all the time, and it's a reference point, it's a barometer for now how we deal with terrorism, which is the new communism. But it's only depicted in certain ways, and it totally erases the people who are involved, the people who are here now because of it. So I've encountered a lot of people who say, oh, well, it's weird that, like, I'm in the same room as you because, you know, my grandfather fought your grandfather. And I was like, no, dummy, like, you don't even, that's not how it worked. There's North and South Vietnam, and then you kind of have to lay out this history for people. So they only pick up on certain things like, oh, yeah, the hippies were, like, smoking weed and saying, no, Vietnam, and forgetting, you know, the much more complex history. So it's kind of a resistance against that lazy, reductive monster in our society that just pits people against one another.
Thank you. And we'll take questions from the audience as well as those who may be online.
We do have
microphones on either side of the aisle. You can just step up, please.
Well, let me begin by thanking you all for coming here and speaking. This has been very enlightening. And I'd just like to pose the general question following up on what Jade said as to what your thoughts are on the most effective ways to get the truth out there.
Sounds like the X-Files. The truth is out there.
I was just going to say, to tell you the truth, I think it's a very hard question. I think, you know, these days, anything that you put out there in the world is immediately subject to so much tearing apart, so many comments, so much trolling, all of that. I don't have the answer. I just wanted to say that I think being a writer is a drastically different thing than it was, you know, 10, 20 years ago when you could, you know, publish something and then quietly go about your business and maybe 3 months later get a letter from somebody saying, you know, I disagreed strongly with what you said, and, you know, or I really appreciated what you said, and I think it's an evolving problem. I personally have responded to this environment by not participating at all in social media and that sort of thing, simply because I find it too overwhelming as a writer to be in the midst of all that noise. But that's, you know, I certainly don't think that's the answer for everyone in terms of how to deal with this sort of truth problem.
I mean, I think the best thing you can do is put it out there and hope that somebody reads it and it sparks a light in their mind, and then they go and tell somebody else and it sparks a light in their mind, and that's how word gets around, sort of the old-fashioned way, or someone tweets it. I don't know, maybe it's that's how the word gets around, but and you have to do the best you can and hope that it catches on and you don't wind up getting heaped with abuse
from crazy people.
You know, the one redeeming thing for me, and maybe Rachel, you feel this way too, but is when I'm in the classroom and or with students and you're seeing how literature can really connect people and the students are bonding and you've got a 19-year-old who's never read a full book before into reading a whole book. That for me is the light of hope that, you know, we can seek out this truth and use words and stories and memories to connect with one another still.
I'll just say one other thing. At the moment, it's really important to really consider your news sources and the people whose work you're reading, and put in another plug for a co-panelist. It was mentioned before that Sarah is writing for Vox, and a few days ago you had a wonderful piece sort of exploring refugee issues, and you know, I would recommend follow Sarah and read her work. And just you know, as the saying goes, consider the source a great deal of the time.
Erica's a great hype woman.
I take her everywhere I go.
From this side of the aisle, please.
Less of an academic question, more of a plain everyday human question. A number of you have talked about sort of hitting the wall of asking family members for stories and either from experience of trauma or just plain shame, they don't share. But I wonder if you would talk about experiences of success there. What kind of questions do you ask? And what kinds of things draw that out of people and make them want to share about their past and their experiences?
Well, I'll just say, it's probably, if you're having difficulty getting answers, it's probably not your fault. It's the teller. They're either someone who wants to tell the story or someone who can't or doesn't want to. And I was just really fortunate that I had three really good storytellers. So I would just, you know, ask, you know, tell me about the time, and then they would start in. And so, I mean, you know, it's just, it's not you. You're probably doing nothing wrong. Just persist, I would say. Just keep asking, you know, the same questions. Timing is important.
I actually think that it is about maybe changing the questions. Mm. Because I think sometimes we get stuck in asking the same questions over and over, and so a polished narrative emerges that's hard to work around. And I found that over the course of my life, my questions have changed. And so the hardest thing has been not asking questions in time that only occurred to me too late. But if you start to think of the narrative differently, if you start to take yourself out of thinking that it's a family member and think about it as if you were a journalist approaching this person, what are the questions you'd want to know? What did their family home look like? What did their religious life look like? What did it look like to walk down the street? Did they observe religious holidays? Did they not? What are the things that they missed the most when they left a town behind? You know, what was their favorite teacher like? Did they mostly socialize with people of the same faith? These were things that I didn't think to ask when I was a kid, and over time, but I noticed it. I went into an interview with a woman who'd been a classmate of my grandfather's, though she didn't remember him, and her daughter was there. And I said to her, did you have mostly Jewish friends? And the daughter broke in and said, no, she was totally secular. And the mother said, no, I had only Jewish friends. And so it was really interesting because she was totally secular, but had an entirely secular Jewish community and maybe one non-Jewish friend, but it hadn't occurred to anyone to think of it that way because of how you grew up, which makes total sense.
I was gonna say, I think it's interesting too, as people get older and memories either start to decline or start to become influenced by other sources. Like I think particularly the Holocaust, there's so many narratives out there and people will watch a movie and maybe it's very sensitive and it reminds them of something, but things start melding sometimes. And so I think also when you ask questions, you want to be thoughtful about not being too prodding sometimes. Like my grandfather would never talk about anything, but actually my bubby talked about everything. But if I asked a question, it depended how I phrased the question. If I phrased the question in a certain way, I get one answer. And if I phrased the question in a different way, I get a completely different answer. And part of it, I mean, she's 90, it's hard to answer question. I can't answer probably the same question. I'm not even 90. I'll probably give you another answer tomorrow, you know? But I think that also has to, we have to be respectful and thoughtful of also the influences on people's memory and how we process our experiences as well.
So I'm just going to add it now because I'm going to circle back to also the question about the commonalities. First of all, with Suzanne, it's similar. My grandmother was very talkative and my grandfather wasn't as talkative. And I have all sorts of theories about that. And part of it was that my grandmother actually did start learning English as a child and my grandfather started learning English when he came here and had not finished primary school either in Germany. So it was just very hard for him. So that's just a commonality. But I was also thinking about a scene in Malene's book where you visit this a residence for elderly Armenians, and they're asked to speak about their experiences and and how the narrative shifted. And they're even told, no, this is your story and all of that. So, I mean, that's sort of all coming back to me now as well as something about that question of memory that transcends everyone's, the panelists up here, and how elders have recounted their narratives.
Just a couple quick things to bounce off that. Learn the language of the person you're talking to. Like in Vietnamese, there's so many things, like you don't refer to yourself as I. In America, we do that all the time. I did this, I did that, and it comes off as arrogant, so no one wants to talk to you if you're gonna refer to yourself as I. It's always the familial term. But also when you ask a question, it's always followed by phai kham, which means yes, no. So that kind of opens up this ambiguous terrain for answering a question in more complex ways. Second thing, know that silence is a part of the story too. Don't never push, because I think that silence can speak volumes. And third thing, never underestimate the diva in people. So what I did with my mom and my grandma is I'd like show them a picture and I'd be like, oh, so what's this all about? And they say, no, no, can't talk about it. And then I'd say, okay, I don't care anyway. I'm gonna go watch some MTV. And they'd be like, what? You know, and then I'd get a 4-hour story. So it works.
Please.
Sure, so I wanna first thank you all for coming out and for speaking to us tonight. The genocide of the Holocaust was disturbingly and heartbreakingly successful because of state-sanctioned culture of hate, but there was also crimes of indifference because of conspiracies of silence. Can you speak to the danger of silence, the consequence of indifference, and the responsibility to protect the story? Was that too much?
That was a great question. We are responding with silence.
I know, yeah. Sorry. Unwrap it any way you want to. I'm a sponge. We're sponges.
I'm going to just start so that we start the conversation and responding to your question. The first thing that comes to my mind is that looking at Turkey, for example, a lot of Armenians would feel that everyday Turks are sort of conspiring to continue denying the genocide and all of this. A lot of times people just don't know about something and they don't know even that they don't know. And that's a really complex thing, and it isn't necessarily just limited to everyday people. It can also be, people in an administration, you know, I mean, so I guess my reaction is that, I mean, of course, silence, I mean, I think we all would agree, silence is bad, silence is not good, you know, silence in the face of injustice is horrible, always, of course, but silence is also complex because, you know, and I'm always thinking about in terms of, you know, how can we sort of try to look differently at you know, our other, our so-called enemy, those kinds of things. And, you know, one thing I would say about silence is just to not assume that it's always willful or informed silence, for what that's worth.
Any thoughts about indifference?
About indifference, is that what you said?
Yeah, indifference.
I think it may be hard to know. I mean, I'm thinking of that old saying, you know, actions speak louder than words. So you may not hear someone or read someone's words, but it would be wrong to assume of all such people that they're necessarily indifferent. I mean, there could be actions going on that we're not aware of, for instance. So I guess the thing that about, it's hard, it's just, it's indifference is also very hard to really see sometimes. So I'm not sure.
I actually think that there are a couple layers to this. One is that if you're thinking of Germany specifically, and since I spent a lot of time thinking about this in the terms of volley, what allowed indifference was the incremental nature of the disintegration of the Jewish connection to society. And so it was not that a blind eye was turned necessarily to a mass deportation taking place immediately. What happened was people started to not notice small things or to not feel that small things were being applied universally. So what you hear anecdotally would be that people would say, well, the restrictions would be spoken of from one Jew to a non-Jewish friend if they still had that connection at all. And that friend would say, I didn't realize those applied to everyone. And what you started to see was people weren't paying attention because it happened in such small ways, especially in Berlin itself, where they could slowly, slowly take things away, like meat or dairy, and you wouldn't notice it because it wasn't taken from you, and you actually were starting to feel that your life was under duress as well, because maybe your son had gone to the front, and you know, you had stuff to worry about, and so you couldn't really worry about everybody around you, and hadn't they said that the Jews weren't that great anyway? You know, sort of, you started to incorporate some of the xenophobic tendencies of the press, of the endless propaganda. You started to somehow incorporate some of that into your own thinking, whether you realized it overtly or not. But at the same time, you weren't noticing that things were being taken away, you know, and that you weren't seeing an entire group of people being excised from society. Because unlike in the East, it didn't happen in quite as dramatic and immediate ways. So I think there's that. There's an amazing memorial in Berlin called Silent Heroes. And it looked at some of the people who did help and why, and the motivations behind them. And there I met this incredible woman named Hani, and she had come in to give her testimony. And I said, how did you survive? And she held up her hand and she had one finger missing. And she said, because of this. And she had been on her forced labor factory floor and gotten a finger caught in a machine. And so it was ripped off. And so she was sent to the infirmary. And then that day, the entire factory was rounded up during something called the factory action. This is in February of 43. And so she realizes this, and she immediately tries to go into hiding. She has nothing with her, and she lives on the run for several months. And she starts hiding every day in a movie theater. And she finally sort of tells her story to the ticket taker. And she says to the ticket taker, I have nowhere else to go at this point. She'd sort of used up any contacts she had left. And any Jews who really were able to survive at that point had contacts within the non-Jewish community. If you didn't, you were really sunk. But at this point, she'd used up all of her contacts, and she goes to this woman and says, I have nothing left to lose. And it turned out the woman was a religious woman and had never really liked Hitler or the administration, and had a son at the front. And she said, well, I'm going to make a bargain with God that I'll take you in and pretend that you are my niece or my relative who's been bombed out, and maybe he'll protect my son. And she protected her through the end of the war, and the son survived too.
Wow. Thank you for sharing.
Please.
Hi. I wanted to circle back to this idea of what all the stories have in common, and obviously this is a stage full of women storytellers, which as a woman I think is awesome. And it had me sort of thinking about even just the word history, like his story, and we talk about, you know, needing to have more her story that children are taught and that people discuss. And I'm curious if, like, for anybody on this stage, if there was a point where storytelling felt like a compulsion you needed to act on because of your gender identity, or because as women we're more likely to be forgotten by the generations of the future, and so many women who have come before us, even in our own families, we don't know anything about.
I definitely do. Well, I just want to say, I think it's interesting that three of us talked about how having a child somehow brought the stories forth or influenced the shaping of the stories. So I think that's maybe part of the answer, but also I think like history is one thing and memory is something else, and I think memory is more in the realm of the maternal, that it gets passed on from mothers or grandmothers. So I don't know if we're receptacles more for that in some way than male writers. I don't know.
That's not where I was going to go. But for me, actually, it's interesting because this story became very much about telling the story of a professional woman who would otherwise be forgotten, and in part forgotten because that history isn't as well told, and in part forgotten because, as one of my colleagues mentioned earlier, and now I'm forgetting who said it, but that the men were often told to leave sooner. It was Suzanne. Men were often told to leave sooner because there was an assumption that men would be targeted, but women and children would be saved. And so often men were given the first visas out or encouraged to take the first visas out. And so I met a number of families which were split, where men had made it to the UK, for example, but the women were left behind. And in this case, in Vali's story, she stays behind for her mother. And in fact, doing some digging, I found that there were a large number of women who refused to leave their mothers behind. And that story is told if you look for it, but it's not something we learn about. It's not something that you hear about much. And at some point in one of her letters, she says, "Do you know there are only women left here?"
We have time for one more question, please.
Thanks to all of you for everything that you've done to preserve these stories for us. I think an underlying question is, how can we make these stories real to people who didn't have grandpa, who didn't have grandma, and who don't perceive that they have a lot of connection to the stories? You've talked about research, both the personal interviews and interactions, and also the archival research as one way to make it very real. But I also wonder, what's the role of the imagination in conveying these stories and filling out the many things that we don't know because we weren't told? Thank you.
I mean, in my case, I completely had to rely on my imagination, which fortunately is overactive and very stimulated. And it also a little bit ties back what I'm about to say to the previous question, because the main character in my story is my grandfather, because I wanted to place him in a time and satisfy my own curiosity about what his life had been like before the war, as well as these women who sent him off to protect him. But as I was writing it, really, the women in the story are sort of, their stories are very, very important to the story. And in a way, without anything that they do, he can't move forward. And there are all these subplots that involve his sisters, his mother, his girlfriend, his mistress, whatever. And that's how it became, I thought, a bigger tapestry of life, but really a very, someone read it and was like, "This is a very feminist novel." And I was like, "Thank God, because I'm writing about a male character and I feel like I'm betraying my own values." But everything had to be driven by imagination in my case, except for these very basic facts. Like, this person was born in this year. This person was a butcher. This was this person's address. That's not a lot. That's nice, but it's not really a very interesting story until you make that work in a world you create.
It's a very interesting question for a couple of reasons. One being, especially when you come to questions about the Holocaust, there is some resistance to fiction that deals with the Holocaust. I have not really encountered, back to the question about denial, that resistance. But I have, within communities of readers and writers even, more of a resistance to the idea of writing fiction I had an exchange in the Jewish Review of Books on this question with one of the editors there, too. One of the reasons that I think some of us turn to fiction, certainly in my case, was because there are so many gaps, because there are things that we can't get answers to no matter how hard we try. And sometimes it's fine to write a nonfiction account that has those unanswered questions. There was no way I was ever going to write anything nonfictional that I, quote, changed, to make a better story. I'm one of the people who believes that a memoir as a work of nonfiction should not have anything made up in it. And, a lot of people have different views on that, but when there were things that I knew I wasn't going to be able to address in nonfiction, fiction allowed me, it's a different sort of accordion, in a sense. It allows you to open up stories in ways that you simply can't. And I think that both Rachel and Suzanne also addressed the questions that it's, in a sense, too late to ask, or things that we're not going to be able to find out, but we can come up with plausible and realistic kinds of answers. And hopefully that's certainly been the way that I've approached things.
I just wanted to say, too, that I think even though there is often this concern about fiction, that fiction, and not to diss the nonfiction writers here, but fiction is immersive in a way that I don't think creative nonfiction or memoir is, because you're always aware in reading a memoir that it's something that's already happened to someone else, and fiction tries to put you, the reader, into that story, and I think that's one way to convey a truth, an important, important truths.
And honestly, a lot of my work could be considered nonfiction, but to someone else in my family, it's a fiction. So then we see those lines blurred again, everything being very subjective. Alice Walker's daughter, Rebecca, wrote a memoir, Black, White, and Jewish, and she starts out with saying, she's like, I don't even remember myself. So it's hard to remember all of these events that happen. So I tend to kind of let go of the genre impositions and just really see it as a true feeling in a lot of ways, because everyone's stories always contradict each other. Or maybe my family's crazy, I don't know. Probably are, but.
No, yeah. Everybody's story. Yeah.
Please join me in thanking our authors. Special thank you to both our in-theater audience as well as those who tuned in online this evening. Tonight's conversation is part of a new programming series called The Power of Memory to Shape Our Future. Please visit the museum's events calendar at ushmm.org to sign up for museum emails and follow us on social media. Remember, you can purchase books by all the authors as you exit this evening, and they will be available to sign them outside the theater lobby. To everyone joining us here as well as online for the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, I'm Stephen Mize. Good night.